Okay, thank you, thank you, thank you. Hope you like that first song. As I said, I may add on to this video. And since this is just coming right after I said that, give a little time for us to settle down in the wow. I had to take some time to settle down in the wow myself because some other clarification came up, which was extraordinary. Really, wow. How this will get received, I don't know, because I have never even thought about this before. This is really astonishing, but it's wonderful. I mean, just wow. And so I can sing another song, or at least try. Said that this realm of nature, what we see is attempt to, we're marketing force change to God, saying, God, buy this product from us. And God says it doesn't exist. There is no force change. Now, I said supernature is like a place to, where we're marketing life to God. Well, I wasn't quite happy with that. The explanation could be better than this, actually. But I guess I didn't want to. It seems like too much to bring up all at once here. But we can try, because the time is of this incorporation of this planet into a different style of marketing. Force change is going. The tempest is raging and will continue for quite some time. This is a big storm, believe me. It won't stop until civilization is transformed here. Said that this realm that we're familiar with right now is a marketing campaign to market force change or death force change to God. And that doesn't exist. No product to buy. I've also said that marketing life to God also is not a product, which that is means marketing life, you're saying forced non-change. That also doesn't exist in reality. So you can't market that either. And then I said, well, supernature is this marketing life. Well, it's not quite, there's something I need to adjust here a little bit for us here, actually. And in order to do that, I have to sing this other song here. So we have to bear with this. Intellect's always very negative and saying, we can do it faster, you know. Because it's not taking into account the context that we're dealing with here. It's just dealing words and concepts. No context. The intellect doesn't have a context. It's just a boastful bragger, actually. Say, what's taking you so long? So just ignore it like a fly. Buzzing around. My gosh, the birds are just all over the place this morning. It's incredible. Just masses of birds just flying everywhere. And it's already in the middle of the day. Sometimes in the morning, the weather has changed here. It's actually going to go into more like spring-like conditions, if you can believe it. But yeah, last year it did too. In January, we got warm. It's going to warm up to like 74, 76 degrees or something. Anyway, we're going to warm up to this song of salvation. Now, What if we decided, Spirit decided, I'm going to market a product to God. and that market is life. I want to market life to God. Let's say Spirit decided that it would be engaged in marketing life to God. And in truth, marketing life to God is exactly the same in abstraction as marketing death to God, in that both are imaginary products that don't exist, and God can't buy either one of them. So from the standpoint of absolute abstraction, it's the same. It's the same mistake. Now we're here in this realm, okay, of marketing force change, death. But do you know that there are other realms, so to speak, dimensions, realms, where what they're engaged in there is marketing life to God, marketing life to God. And I will set supernature as actually something different. Okay, and I will explain that to you. These so-called higher realms, where they're engaged in marketing life to God, meaning God, everything I see is eternal, it can never change, and that's marketing forced non-change to God, which is also not true. Now, perfect freedom is free to choose a different experience or free to keep the same experience. No preference from God, no pressure from God, no specificity from God, no need to do either one. You can keep what you're experiencing or you can change what you're experiencing. It's all the same. It's all good. And you can go back to what you experienced before and it's the same, 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 same. So, the so-called higher realms, if we want to call that, where we're engaged in trying to market life to God, this too can never succeed, never come to any conclusion. So you could say, and truthfully say, at the level of pure abstraction here, that the higher realms are just as stuck as this so-called realm. And calling them higher implies that they're not so stuck. So these other realms of marketing life to God, let's say there's a realm where we're marketing life to God exclusively. I think this is so beautiful, this is so wonderful. It can't change, it can't change, it can't change. This is, you know, eternal. This is just as much of a problem as marketing death to God, as marketing force change. It's the same problem. There is no conclusion to it because God can't, there's no product for God to buy. You're stuck in it, so to speak. You're stuck in this marketing campaign. So, what I see with cycling through these realms, what I see now is pretty amazing. I see that what happens is, let's say we're in the realm of marketing life to God, and we say, wow, there's no conclusion to this is terrible. And then we see the realms of death, and we say, oh my God, that, you know, this is different. Maybe I can get away from this marketing campaign and do that, and that will somehow balance it out or something. So they then go down, they're attracted to the realm of marketing force change on God, and a way to get away from the other one that doesn't work. And they say, well, maybe this will work. And then once we're in this realm of marketing death to God, force change, we get so tired of this, it doesn't work, this is horrible. And then we see these realms of marketing life to God, and we say, oh my, I'm going there. You know, they call it heaven, I'm going there. And so we go there, thinking that this will help us escape from our unsuccessful attempts here. And maybe we're thinking it balances it out. But what happens is, when we get to those realms of marketing life, we get totally wrapped up into that, and that doesn't work either. And then we come back here, we get totally wrapped up in marketing force change. Then we go there, and we get totally wrapped up in marketing force non-change. Then, so we keep cycling through the, like this. We get born in this realm, we die, we go to these other realms. We then decide we gotta leave these realms, this isn't it. We come back here, hopeful of hope that this will help us out. And we keep cycling like this, okay? Now, I brought up supernature and introduced supernature as the answer to get free of this cycling. Free of this cycling. From marketing life, and then switching over to marketing death, marketing force change, marketing force non-change. What supernature does is, it seems as though both are there. It seems as though both marketing campaigns are there. So what you're able to do there is really balance it out to the point where you can then set both of these campaigns down, marketing force change and marketing non-force change, together. You can set them down together, which is what we ultimately have to do. We have to set all marketing campaigns down. That includes the marketing campaign of death or force change, and the marketing campaign of force non-change, which we call marketing campaign of life. In supernature, you have the marketing campaign of life there, because everything doesn't change. Nothing changes. Okay, so you can see that. But you also have the marketing campaign that is familiar to you with forced change, in that the potential is there. All the forms you see of nature, you know, we identify those forms with forced change. Okay, so it reminds us of that, so to speak. And I did notice there that it seems as though there's some evidence of the forms having increased in size somewhat, or something is apparent like that. So there's something that reminds you there of both campaigns. But what happens is, let's say you're saying, hey, I don't want to, this marketing campaign of forced non-change doesn't work, and oh, I'm noticing that, I kind of want to get away from that. And then you can look at it and say, oh, all of these trees and everything, this reminds me of the marketing campaign of forced change, right? But then when you say, you know what, I want to get away from the forced change marketing campaign, then you can look at it and say, oh yeah, but nothing has happened to these trees, or whatever, but nothing's happened to nature. So nature reminds us of forced change. The fact that none of nature's changing reminds us of the marketing campaign of non-forced change. And so we go through this balancing, this process of sort of, okay, I really don't want this, I want the other one. Okay, I really don't need this, I'll the other one maybe. Okay, and then we kind of are able to like get into this balance, like, wow. You kind of say, you know what, I don't really need this one so much, and then let me look at the other one. I don't really need this so much, let me look at the other one. Like that. And so there's sort of both of these campaigns are represented there. Both of these campaigns are represented there. But you stop your cycling. The cycling you do is there, you just kind of say, yeah, this is wonderful. And then gradually you might think, ah, but I don't quite want that campaign. And then, oh, I see the other now, sort of. It's sort of there too. I see the other one, but it's not quite, you know, there. And then the other one. And gradually, you realize, I don't need either one. I don't need either one. So you stop your cycling. Stop your cycling. You're no longer a cyclist. This is the miraculous nature of the situation, of supernature. This is the miracle of supernature. This answers so many questions, because we hear of these gods and goddesses in the higher realms, like, you know, these you know, death-free realms, so to speak, but it's a little different than that. It's, they're in these realms that, where it's really a marketing campaign of life to God, which is saying, God, I have this product of where nothing can change, forced non-change. Nothing can change. Experience remains exactly the same forever. And we want to market, we want you to buy that product from us and take that burden off us, because we don't, you know, it feels oppressive. So those in the so-called higher realms, actually, they're feeling very oppressed also by their marketing campaign, because they want some change. They want different experiencing. Whereas here, we're oppressed by this constant forced change. And we say, wow, I just want some stability, more stability here. This is horrible. I just want to feel like I'm 25 years old all the time. I don't want this aging and dying of the body instead. It's forced change. No. I want some stability. In the market realms of marketing life, they say, hey, this is too stagnant. I want some change. I want some change. But I got to get God to buy this first. And so then, if they can't get God to buy it, of course, so then they come down into this realm. So the so-called the higher gods and goddesses, they end up coming down here and saying, wow, I'm so happy to be here, this is great. And then we end up going there and saying, wow, this is wonderful, I enjoy this. But after a while, we say, no, this isn't it either. So we've simply been cycling through these cycles for over and over and over and over and over and over again. Can't seem to get out of it. Now we know. Supernature, supernature, supernature. you can call those two marketing campaigns of Nirvana and Samsara, for instance, to use Buddhist Hindu terminology, Nirvana and Samsara. They're essentially the same. They're both marketing campaigns. Those in Nirvana get tired of it, say this isn't quite it. They come back here to Samsara, and those in Samsara get tired of this, and they want to go to Nirvana realm, like that. But supernature seems to be both Samsara and Nirvana. And from that experience, since you know, you don't go to supernature and stay there unless you know what it's about. Otherwise, you'll be freaked out. You'll be confused. Which is it? Which is it? Well, I can't figure it out. Which is it? and I'm going to lose my marketing campaign. Wait a minute. I can't get into it enough here. You know, I can't get it. So only those who understand what it's about can abide in supernature. Abiding in supernature, you know what it's about. You know what the purpose is. It's sort of to a balancing act where you gradually realize you don't need either one. As you start getting tired of one, there's the other. You get tired of it, there's the other. You get tired of that, there's the other. And so it seems like kind of both are there. The forms that we've used for marketing death are there. Nature. But the quality we've been using to market life is there, which is nothing changes. Right? No change. So they're both there. And it's not an attempt to confuse us. It's an attempt to let us come out of this need for any cycling anymore. And then realize I don't need any marketing campaign at all. I understand reality now, how it is. It's neither forced change nor neither forced change nor no change. Forced non-change. Neither forced change nor forced non-change. There's no force there at all in reality. We're absolutely free. So, the gods and goddesses of the Nirvanic realms, and you may wonder, well, they're the greatest, and they look at us and actually say, wow, we really want to get into this. This looks like a lot of fun. And the answer is no, they're not. They're not. That it's going into supernature is the wise move to make. This is the Holy Spirit's marketing campaign. Supernature is actually the Holy Spirit's marketing campaign to God. For us, on our behalf. And whereas the marketing campaigns of forced change, which is this the universe of nature, and the marketing campaign of forced non-change, which is the so-called subtler realms, those are our marketing campaigns to God. Supernature is the Holy Spirit's marketing campaign to God. Knowing full well what it's marketing is reality, actually. Holy Spirit knows this, that there is neither life nor death in reality. There's neither forced change nor forced non-change in reality. There's no force at all. There is the isness. Reality is always what we want it to be. Without any forced need to change, and no forced need to not change. And that is why each moment feels complete and perfect in itself, because it is. So this answers even. You know, the birds are acting like it's springtime. Busy, 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 getting all sorts of food, moving around, singing. Wow. Just everywhere. So we think here in this world that the gods and goddesses in the nirvanic realms are somehow superior to us. And so when they're coming down into this world, we think we need to wait here and welcome them and show them, you know, it's like an honor to have you here. Then let us show you this world. Let us help you. You know, like, wow, they're here to enlighten us. No, they're not. They're here to get this, to market forced change like crazy. You know, this is what they're going into. The ones going into the nirvanic realms, you know, the ones that may think, oh, here we are, we're coming forth with the answers. No, we're not. We're here then. We're here to market forced non-change. So, certainly we don't have to wait around in this marketing of forced change here for these, you know, so-called high gods and goddesses, these, you know, to come in here and think, wow, we're really being graced and blessed by their appearances here. Not at all, they're just cycling. They're just doing their cycling work. As as everyone else is doing their cycling work. Ultimate realization, neither samsara nor nirvana. They're both the same, rising in the same absolute freedom of pure spaciousness, all pervasive, pure spaciousness, and absolute freedom. Neither forced change nor forced non-change. But our problem is the familiarity with marketing campaigns. We're familiar with both the campaign of marketing light, of forced non-change, and the marketing campaign of death, forced change. So we believe our functioning is marketing to God, trying to market something to God. That is not our functioning in reality. There's nothing to market to God. You see, this is the delusion. We believe that we need to market something to God. There's nothing to market to God at all. There can never be a product, there's nothing to market. So, to function the way we are created to function, the way we really want to function, is we need to set down all marketing campaigns. You see? But if we start setting down just one of these marketing, forced marketing campaign of forced change. What about all our familiarity with the marketing campaign of forced non-change? That's a marketing campaign too. And so then we swing to that one. And we try to set that one down, we swing to the other one. So what you have to do is set them down both together. Set them down both together. The supernature is designed to enable us to set them down both together. It's not a place where we can, where there's to indulge in both and learn how to do both better. That will get us confusing because each one seems, we keep getting our attention onto the other one. So if we go into that with that motive, we can't stay there. We'll say, oh, no, I don't want this place. This is weird, too weird. But if we go there with the motive to set them down both together, then we'll welcome it. We'll say, oh, yeah, this is very helpful. This is a very helpful scenario. It's like you can interpret it either way. You can look at supernature and interpret it either way. But neither way is that convincing. Neither way is that convincing. And you can see it both ways. And neither one is entirely convincing. And so you yourself start saying, hey, wait a minute. You can't really market either one of those, can you? And then so the opportunity to set it down both together, both marketing campaigns. So this is a growing clarity here. I didn't expect this. This is more than expected. This is just, wow, I don't even know what to make of it. Quite astonishing, but it's okay. It's both expected and not expected. I expected the arrival of clarification at some point. You never expect it right now. We're not sure when to expect it. So whenever it comes, it's kind of like, wow, that was amazing. But yeah, and it's the right time for it because of the world. The storms will be more ferocious than people realize, ideologically. You know, this is an ideological takeover, which can be done without any shots being fired, actually. Absolutely. That's what they prefer. But it's a takeover nonetheless. I mean, the whole idea of shots being fired is to prevent the takeover, you know? That's war survived, to prevent the takeover. Yeah. So, I mean, if the takeover occurs, that's the outcome you don't really want, you know? So, you know, just because no shots were fired doesn't mean the takeover is what we really want. It just means that they were clever enough to do it without having any, you know, any much resistance. Coming from the realms of forced non-change, marketing that, the marketing campaign of that forced non-change, those who coming from there can come into this realm here and say, hey, everybody, I know how to stabilize everything here. You know, we can solve the problems of the world, no problem. Climate change, droughts, we know how to stabilize everything, don't worry. People say, wow, you got the answers, huh? But then the longer they stay here, the more they get into forced change. Like, hey, wait a minute, I don't really want to stabilize it that much. You know? And it ends up becoming, well, the way it's always been here, you know, forced change. And when we go to Nirvana, we say, hey, everybody, I know how to bring forced change here. And they say, oh, really? Great. They can help us out. But then you end up getting into, you know, the forced non-change marketing campaign. Isn't this an interesting conundrum? Yeah, and in supernature, both elements seem to be there sort of like, wow. And if you understand this, then you're going to sit there and just enjoy it. Because you know automatically it's evaporating your continuity fear, automatically. Nothing you need to do, really, hardly. Just your attention, you know, just stay in the flow of this experiencing. Now, like a pristine golf course here is an example of supernature, for example. You go there, and you think, wow, everything here could get all out of hand. You know, the trees could go over, the grass could get, the weeds, the light. I mean, I can see the potential for this all to go to ruin, you know, but it's all immaculate, you know. He's like, wow, it's nothing is being forced to change here. It all seems to be just pristine like that. But you see the potential for it to be non-pristine. You recognize that. You say, well, what if this weren't pristine? Yeah, but it is. But its potentially could not be. So supernature, you see all the forms of nature and say, well, you know, the potential for all this stuff to go bonkers like nature, you know, turn to the jungles there. But on the other hand, it's not happening. And then flip it around. If you know, you say all the pristineness is all here. Okay, that's great. But the potential for it to go great, bad, change is there. Or we could say, oh yeah, the potential for the change is here, but if we don't want that, the pristineness is here. You know, either one, the pristineness could go away. Or the pristineness could actually say, you know what, I could force this, I could get to have this remain exactly the same forever, but the potential for it not be is also there. So that's reassuring. And then flip it around and say, yeah, I see the potential for this to all go to pieces there, but I see it could be kept pristine. That's nice. See, like that. You see a golf course and you say, oh yeah, it could go bad, but I see that's being kept pristine. So that reassures you. If you want it to go bad, it reassures you. Potentially say, oh yeah, it could laugh. If this pristineness is too much for me, I can see how it go away. And on the other hand, the pristineness says, I see that this could go, you know, to seed, so to speak. And if that gets too much for me, I know I can make it remain pristine. They might say, oh, that's nice. I see the potential for it to go to seed. That's great. It could turn into jungle. Yeah, that's great. But I can keep it the pristine forever if I want to, you know? So it's like both of that is there. Both of that is there. So the forms, the potential is there, and then the pristineness is there. Potential for the nature to burst into, you know, what we are used to here in this world. That's there. And the potential for pristineness to always be there is there, and preventing that is there. Pristineness is, I could replace this with something that is totally symbolic in a way that it seems like it inherently can't change. But now I like this, seeing these nature forms, because it seems like maybe they could change. And this helps balance that out. Yeah. So this has been an unexpected development, all of this, and fresh and unique and unexpected. You know, there's this subtle wow to it, actually, and that has to be recognized. Sometimes it's so stunning that you're in shock, you don't even realize it. And they just go on. Before you know it, the wheels are coming off in your life, because you're actually in a state of shock, partial shock, because, you know, this is good news to such an extent that... Now, I remember I did have that dream I was talking about. Let's say there's a dream of the person escaping the tempest, and they're in this beautiful, calm water, ocean. Now, what I remember is... looking back, let's say we look back, we're in that area, we look back and we can see the tempest is there, and yet here we are in the calm water. It's like that. It's like I could go back into the tempest if I wanted to. But I'm in this calm water here. So it's not like I have to go back to the tempest, and it's not like I have to stay in this calm water either. This calm water, or maybe beyond the calm water, is like a frozen lake, so to speak, where there's no change is possible, seems no change is possible, vast frozenness. So I'm in this, we're still in this water, it's not frozen. On one hand, there's this vast frozenness, on the other hand, there's this ferocious tempest with water just flying everywhere and wind. One place you have this frozen land, just nothing, still and frozen. And the other is this wild tempest, and you're here just in this liquid ocean, just calm and peaceful ocean. That's like super nature, in between the two. You could look both ways and say, you know what, I don't really want either one of those. I don't want either one of those. Neither one is it. And beyond that, we cannot speak of, because it's just absolute freedom. And there's nothing to speak of about that, because it's anything and everything. It's both whatever we want, and no force to keep it, or no force to get rid of it. Multiple types of birds everywhere. Maybe they're hungry. The winter, the cold winter is over. It lasted about a week in California, the cold winter. It actually came in on December 24th with a severe thunderstorm, didn't it? And today is, I think, the 4th, so it's been about 11 days. So we, you know, week and a half of winter, basically, is what we had. But the temperatures did get down like 29 degrees, and it was clear and cold. And yeah, week and a half of winter is what we had. I think I've ever seen so many birds. The entire landscape here is just alive with birds flying around, all types, jumping into bushes. I guess they're getting something, berries or something, you know, everywhere. Well, there's robins all over the place. Robins, it's January 4th, the robins are like totally active here. Wow. Uh-oh. Here in California, we're concerned about the drought. It stopped raining entirely after a couple weeks of rain, and now it's just been nothing. And robins are already showing up. That's, you know, unusual. I can't remember them showing up this early. So, just getting familiar with this song is very helpful. Knowing the song, if you know the song. Now, being someone who has been a musician, forced change, and forced no change. I know about learning songs now. I went through a phase where I decided I need to learn all the songs there were on the radio. And I'd sit in a chair all day and just listen to the radio and learn how to play all the songs. And so I became an expert in learning songs, how to learn songs. And so I know there's a certain way you have to listen to it and focus on it to actually learn the lyrics and learn the song. And once you learn it, you know, you know it, you got it. Once you got it, you got it. But if you don't have it, you don't have it. And just imagine you had to go out and perform the song. If you don't have it, you don't have it. So you better get it. You know, you better get it. And there's a way to do it. You get the context of the song, okay? And you simplify, you realize, okay, there's these choruses, and the choruses are the same, pretty much the same. What's the hook line of the chorus? So you get the hook line, okay, and then how do you lead up to that hook line? And then you get the choruses, you know the chorus, and then you see how many verses, there's a couple verses, okay. What's this first verse about? And then what's the second? And what are the, you know, the hook lines? And you work and go over and over and over and over. And then you get the song and you play it, and then after, you know, doing it over and over, then it clicks in, and then, you know, you got it. You know the song. You get this feeling, I know that song. And this is what musicians, a lot of them have to do. They have to learn songs. They have to get the song. They know the song. So it's the same thing with this song of salvation. If you don't get it, you say, wow, I don't quite get it yet. If you listen to the radio just as a entertainment, you might hear the same song 1,000 times and still not be able to know what the lyrics are or how to sing it or perform it. You don't know it. You can say, oh, I know that song. I've heard that. And then say, okay, sing it. I can't remember the lyrics exactly. And I'm not sure. One way of, like, if I learned songs was in the car, a truck or car driving. I had it on the CD, repeat, and I'd sing along, after about 20 times, you know, I know all the words, all those songs, and can learn. Sometimes you can, if you're on a long trip, you can learn like 10 songs, 15 songs on a trip or something. You got them down pat. Of course, over time, if you don't practice, you forget them, so I've forgotten most of those songs for sure. But I do know, you know, how to learn a song, and so, the first time you hear it, you just say, well, I want to learn that song. So then you listen to it again, and you listen to it again, and you listen to it again, and listen to it again. So we keep making videos, keep listening, and your capacity to learn a song gets better and better. Your capacity to hear gets better and better. The wows, you've gone through so many wows. Now we can even get to this mega wow, which is this, how to get free of the cycling, you know, supernature. How to get free of all the marketing campaigns, of both marketing forced change and forced non-change. Neither which can ever be a product. Neither which God can ever buy from us. So we can never be relieved from the burden of these until we set the actual marketing campaign down, because the entire burden is the marketing campaigns. Those are the burdens that we have, and the cycling between these marketing campaigns and the intermediate areas between them, you know, kind of as we cycle. This is the burden. This is the burden we have. And we have to set the marketing campaigns down, the cycling of these through all these marketing campaigns. Those have to be set down all as one, all as quote-unquote marketing campaignness, you know, believing our functioning is marketing campaignness, no matter what we're selling, right? You could be selling this or selling that or trying marketing this, marketing that. Set down the function of being engaged in marketing campaignness. All of it has to go together. So both marketing force change and marketing force non-change have to go together. Because I don't need anymore. I don't need to function as marketing campaigns because there's nothing, there is no product to sell reality. Reality can never be reduced to a product. It's impossible. Reality can never be reduced to a definition. It's impossible. These birds sound like little dogs barking. Bunch of baby chihuahuas or something barking. I don't think I've ever heard these birds. What are they? One who's in supernature could have access to, you know, all marketing campaigns. This could be explained to both in Nirvana and Samsara. Absolutely. Say, hey, there's a place where you can set down all marketing campaigns together. Why don't you try that? You know, let's get ready for that. That's the answer. That's what really works. Generally, those who are interested in this are the ones that are kind of tired of both, saying, I don't know what the answer is. I don't want either one. What do I do? You know, you reach this sort of existential crisis where you don't want to keep cycling, but you don't know what the answer is. I just, neither one works. I mean, just, I can't find anything to market. You know, it just doesn't work. Then you're all ears, you know, for hearing this. We think those who enter into Nirvana, oh wow, they're the greatest. And those in Nirvana probably think that those who enter into this realm, wow, they're super adventurous, aren't they? They're like, wow, they're the greatest, you know? Breaking free, but and they're finding something because they can market as success, but I know they'll be a great success. No, no, and no. No, no success. God, there's nothing to buy. And we keep waiting for God to help us, you know. Help us out, God. Just buy. Buy it. That's all. That's all you gotta do. Help us out. You don't want to help us? Terrible. You ever get so angry at God? See, wow, how come God is being so difficult? All God has to do is just buy the product we're selling. Come on. And then we'll be saved. And God doesn't want to save us, we think, because God's not buying the product. And there's no product to buy. There's no product. Reality can't be changed. There's no product in reality. Reality can never be reduced to any product whatsoever. So we're getting angry at God for no reason. Or we're sweet-talking God. See, it's a marketing campaign. Come on, God, you can do it. You can buy it. You want to buy it. You know you want to buy it from me. I'm so nice. You know, that's a marketing style. You know, we difference. We might call it the feminine marketing style. We have that. And we have the masculine marketing style. It says, come on, God, this is a great deal. Look how wonderful this product is. You can't miss up on this deal. You know, I'm telling you, this is absolutely awesome. You're going to love it. I want you to buy it. You know, you got to do this. You know, you can do it. I know you can do it. This is what you want to do, and you know, more forceful, you know, and the others just, you know, do it for me, God. I'm so nice, but you're a nice person, lovely, attractive, and it's, you know, you're gonna work. These are different marketing styles we're using, and none of them work at all. None of them work. Again, it's just a marketing campaign. Bodies, worlds, it's all 100% just a marketing campaign we're engaged in. We're producing this marketing campaign. We're the ones producing it. We're producing the masculine approach, producing the feminine approach, we're producing nature, we're producing all this stuff. It's a campaign, marketing campaign, advertising. We're using all the different graphics for God. These are all graphics, all symbols, graphics, images for God. Here, God will make it attractive for you. That's why you haven't bought it yet, but it's not attractive enough. Or it's not, you know, strong enough. You know, oh God, this product is going really strong. Nothing can beat it. I'm telling you, it's tough. It's rough. It's like a pickup truck. You know, it's just nothing can beat it. It's going to last forever. It's going to last. You're going to love it. You know, and that's one approach, right? Yeah, there's a God, would you just do a little something? Would you just do me a little favor? You know, just a little favor for me, God. A little of me and make me so happy if you just do this little favor. Just a little thing, you know. It's not Philly's, but I just have this little cute little fuzzy warm product here for you. If you could just, can I just give it to you? I'd be so happy. It'd make me so happy. I just, wow, it's beautiful, huh? It's a little thing here. Can you do like that? That's the other way. I was God, what can God do? There's no product. Sorry, no product. I can't take no product off your hands, you know. Your problem is the marketing campaign. And I can't take that off your hands either, because you would feel that would be forced. Forced change, right? Yeah, so you got to set it down yourself. But here's a way to do it. Here's a way, supernature. You can set both of them, you know, the marketing campaigns down. And we're thinking, nah, God's a tough nut to crack. A lot of sales resistance there. We gotta keep working on it. So cosmic collective culture comes in and says, like, you know what? We have a really good way to break down God's sales resistance. We really are great at breaking down sales resistance. The world's, look how we're doing with you. We're able to break down your sales resistance. So just think how great we can do with God if we all get together and work on this together. We're gonna break down God's sales resistance. And we know eventually God will finally crack and say, okay, I'll buy it from you. I'll buy death from you. I'll buy life from you, you know. This is all in vain, 100%, totally forever in vain, this approach. And you can laugh at these, because we've always used these approaches. Our campaign is quite funny. It's the one is, look how pretty I am, God, look how attractive, look how beautiful. But if you don't buy this little fuzzy little thing from me, you know what? I'm going to cry. I'm going to be sad. I'm going to deface myself. I'm going to go to pieces. I'm going to, you know, just look horrible and ugly if you don't buy this from me. Well, you don't want that to happen, do you, God? You know? So you don't want me to just, you know, there's all this beauty to just to go to pieces and, you know, tearing my hair out and screaming. Come on, you can fight. Come on, you don't want that, do you? So we just have all these clever little strategies we're using trying to sell God nothing. You know, that no product at all. And we're trying to sell God on this no product. So it is funny. It is very funny. What is it? Guaranteed, God, your money back. Double your money back, as a matter of fact. You don't like W. And we're going to throw in a whole bunch of other stuff along with that non-product. We'll throw in a whole bunch of other non-products with that non-product. You know what? You don't like that nothing? You can return that nothing. Anytime. No questions asked. And along with that, you have nothing. Then you have also a whole bunch of these other little nothings too that we'll sell you. We'll throw it in free of charge. Free of charge. Iron. Platinum guarantee. You don't like it, within 5 days, return it. Man, we guarantee. God, you can keep it forever. We'll never ask for it back. You can have it forever. You can have nothing forever. It's a non-product, no product. You can have it forever. It will never come back, try to repossess it from you or anything. It's permanent. It's permanently nothing. Your guy must be having some little laugh at this. We're certainly very creative in how we try to market nothing. The absence of any product. And, you know, we'll say, God, you have won $10 million, actually. All you have to do is just send a little money to buy this, you know, nothing, no nothingness. And we'll send you all this money as soon as you send in your remittance for this. And they say, God, we're going to return to, you know, functioning the way you created us to function. We're going to drop all this marketing. Like that. As soon as you just buy this little product we have, then we'll just drop all this and everything will be great. We'll call it good and no problems. What do you say? What do you say? And so we keep this up. We keep thinking, how can I market this to? So we keep working with one another on this marketing campaign. So what do you think about this? And we try it out on each other. So we're trying out all these crazy marketing campaigns on ourselves, saying, why don't you pay the role of God and I'm gonna market this to you? What do you think? You know, and so you try it and say, yeah, that might work, you know. And so we use one another here to bounce ideas off of, trial runs off of, you know, like that. And say, maybe I've got to come up with something here. You know, God's a real tough sales resistance. I don't know what it is, what the problem is. So why don't you play God? You have tough sales resistance. I'll play the one that breaks down your resistance, and we'll see if we can get there. So this is the relationships in this world, right? Stuff we do. You think that works? And yeah, it worked on me. It should work pretty. It should work mine. Maybe work on God. Okay, let's try it. You know, waiting. Nothing happened. Oh, God. Didn't buy that one. I have to try something else. Wow. We're so surprised. We're thinking, my gosh, this sales resistance must almost be broken by now, don't you think? And here come the cosmic corporate culture. Cosmic corporate culture saying, yeah, don't worry, God's almost got it. And as soon as we're in charge, folks, definitely we're going to make the sale. We're going to close the deal. We are going to close the deal. Here comes the closer now. This is the closer coming in to close the deal. So don't worry. And we all say, oh, great. Most people do say, oh, okay, yeah, you got all these gadgets and stuff, fancy graphics. Oh, I understand. Wow, you can do a presentation like that. Wow, yeah, we'll do a wireless presentation of God. This is what God's been waiting for. See, God says, you know what? I just need a little more fancy presentation because you haven't quite sold me on it yet, but we're going to do it wirelessly, holographically wireless. Here you go, God. And then God's going to say, wow, that's a very fancy presentation. Yeah, there must be something there, right? There must be something. Okay, my resistance is gone. Let me buy. This is what's going on. It's really quite hilarious and quite silly, actually. Yeah, let's try this out. Let me, instead of asking God directly, I'm going to tweet God. God, I'll send you a tweet. Maybe that'll lead God. Maybe you'll say, oh, wow, this is cool. I can just tweet you? Yes. I don't know. Oh, yeah, God just doesn't want to say yes to directly. He wants to tweet us a yes. Yes, I'll buy. Okay, let me tweet God. God, you ready to buy? Yeah, ready to buy. So, trying to, you know, it's the style of asking. We got this, the way we ask, we think. It's just how we're asking. We need to make it more sophisticated, you know, ask at a distance or something. You know, and then our prayers out, that's too direct. God is offended by that because it's too direct. We need to do a little more indirect, a little more sophisticated. Have an app, an asking app, Ask God app. Yeah, use an app. You got your Ask God app. You know, try that out. Yeah, quickly. God is waiting for an answer. So everybody's here. They're all kind of confident. You know, hey, we're pretty confident that this is it. We'll close the deal. Don't worry. We'll close the deal. Don't worry. Say, I don't think. And I think just fundamentally there isn't any product that God can say yes to, so I don't think it's going to work, you know. I say, no, we're going to close the deal, got to close the deal, we're waiting for it, almost here. So you have those, you know, those two types, the ones that are all gung-ho in this world right now, yeah. He said, we got the pressure on God now, yeah. And the others say, I don't think that's going to work. I don't think anything's going to work. I don't think you have a product at all here. You know, no, we're going to go. Yeah, it's going to work. Yeah, it's going to work. Yeah. Driving another. Yeah, It's going to work. This is the fourth dimensional, right? It's going to work. Yeah. I just got to affirm it's going to work. And then we're saying, I don't think anything is gonna work because there isn't any product. So what works is setting down marketing altogether. I think that's what's gonna work, and yeah, I can do that. And meanwhile, the fourth dimensionals are so it's gonna happen today, right now, huh? Like that. Drink some more coffee, and go to work past the work hard, almost there, just about there, you know. Get in the morning, okay, today's the day, okay, it's gonna work, God's gonna say yes today, you get these preachers, I know everybody, God's gonna say yes to you today, today's the day God is gonna say yes to you. Yeah, today's the day. God's gonna say yes to you. You just gotta say yes to God first. And then God's gonna say yes to you. There's this, thank you, God. Thank you. I say yes to you. You say yes. You just gotta let God know that you believe in the product that you're selling God entirely. And you know you're gonna stand behind that product and you know it's guaranteed. You know, and it's got the stamp of approval on it. You just got to accept that you've got the stamp of approval on that. What you're selling God, and when you got that stamp of approval on it, God's going to buy it from you, and you're going to be saved today. I got the stamp of approval. You just got to believe. You got to have faith that you got the stamp of approval. You have been pre-approved for God to accept your product. You just got it. And now you got that too going on, right? Yeah. The third dimensionals and the fourth dimensionals, it's just, we got the answer. We know how to get a yes from God. We know how to get it. We're almost there, as a matter of fact. Yeah, we're almost there. Yeah, we got it. So we just have to say, no. There's never going to be a yes from God to any product we're trying to sell God. There are no products. God can't say yes to any products. There aren't any. If God said yes to a product, we'd know that God isn't God. You know, it's kaput. Reality's kaput. You know? There isn't ever going to be a yes from God to some product or something, like forced change or forced non-change. Not ever. We can sit forever, I believe that I got the approval, and I just have faith that someone got the approval for me, so I know God's going to say yes, and I'm just waiting for that yes. Waiting for the yes, No. Don't be a naysayer, they say. What's the matter with you? You're being a naysayer. Come on, have faith. I have faith in reality. In reality, can never be a product. There's no such thing as a product. We cannot come up with a product. In reality, it's impossible. So God, the reason why God's not saying yes is there's no product to say yes to. There will be. Naysayers is the only thing that this say, but it's nay to everything, all attempts, all marketing attempts, but yes to super nature, because we understand, we have a functioning familiarity fear, like, oh my God, how am I going to function without trying to market a product? I don't know how to do that. I forgot. Wow. I thought marketing product, non-existent products was my function. I thought God told me to do this. I thought this is what God wants. God wants me to spend all eternity marketing a non-existent product to God, which I can never say yes to. And that's my function in reality, I think. Maybe not. Maybe I just did this on a whim. Maybe I just did this all on a whim. God didn't tell me to do it at all. That makes a lot more reasonable, isn't it? Yeah. Otherwise, it'd be pretty harsh, wouldn't it? Spend all eternity marketing a non-existent product of God, doing everything you can to get God to say yes and always failing. That doesn't seem like much fun to spend all eternity doing that, does it? So, yeah, let me take a closer look here. Maybe it was just a whim I had. I want to see if I can change reality, you know, turn it into a product. Oh, I can't do it? Oh, that's okay. Then I just stop trying to do that then. No harm, no foul. It's like trying to lose weight. It's, you know, you got to have a lot of discipline. Don't distract yourself after this video. Don't distract yourself. Just hang out and do nothing if it's possible. It's like dieting. Don't snack at night. Don't snack. Don't go for the crackers. Don't go for the pretzels. Don't go for the, you know. It's hard because they're sitting around there. You got them there. Wow, birds everywhere flying. I gotta hit that good number on the scale tomorrow. Gotta have a good number show up. Otherwise, I'll get discouraged. So better not snack. Better not snack. Same thing after this video. Don't go snacking on distraction. This is great stuff. This is. Yeah, I know. We've had less than a lifetime of being immersed in all this. I know a good song when I hear it. You know, if I'm enjoying this song, you know, I'm feeling it. I say, yeah, this is a song we're singing. This is a song we're singing. This, you know, expands our expectations and just, wow, opens up. Wow. I see what I've been doing. I see what I've been doing for so long. Wow. He's kind of like, realize this is the story of existence. And this is the story of how to set existence down. Set the marketing campaigns down all together, but gently, gradually, just gradually let the attraction and the attachment to all these together subside, and so you can say, don't need any marketing campaigns, it's fine with that. It was all a whim. You see, it's all a whim. God didn't tell me to do it. It was all my own silly whim. I said, let me have some fun with this. Let me see if I can market reality to itself. Let me see if I can market reality to itself. As I always said, reality doesn't need reality. Meaning, it doesn't need us to market reality to reality. Reality doesn't need us to market reality to reality. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. This is what we eventually come to accept. Eventually. The circus is in town, circus of birds, Cirque de Pajaro or something, Cirque de Birdie. Huh? Cirque de Birdies. It's just 360 degrees, just everywhere. Just flying. A hummingbird just flew in. Kind of cool. Kind of nice. Have an audience here for the taping. You know? Now, not distracting yourself often means don't you start reading stuff. And, wait a minute, let me see if I can understand this reading better now. I read this. I don't. I had to avoid that yesterday. I said, let me go back, Journey Beyond Words. Let me see if it's in. I said, whoa, wait a minute. Not everything is in there. You know, you can't put everything in a book. So I realized, hey, this is momentum is great. Let me just write this momentum. I don't want to read any book. Don't want to read Longchenpa, Jesus, Nanda Maimon, Ramana Maharshi. No. This is good stuff. Let this clarify on its own. On it, just you know, and see what happens. Wow. So I didn't get into any of that stuff. I pick up the book and I say, I'm going to read this. No, forget it. No. Because I know this specifically isn't in there. Specifically. Okay. So that's fine. Not everything is going to be in any book, actually. This requires, you know, real willingness and clarity and context to see this. And if this was presented in a book as the goal, here it is, then the rest of the book it'd be too difficult. So how can I get there? You can't, you know, you don't want to overwhelm the reader too much. Give them feeling like, hey, I can do this, let you know, and then eventually out of that you're then able to focus on something, even just like doing the first song. I focused on supernature and the marketing plan of force change, and then suddenly I realized, hey, wait, I can even go further and talk about the marketing program of forced no change. And realize that the cycling and then supernatural, and I put the whole thing together, which was a step beyond. Whereas if that was presented at first, I might have had trouble getting to it. You see, so you get kind of part of the puzzle, and then you're able to put the whole picture together at some point. It's too intimidating to get the whole picture starting out, and then it's like, wow, how can I get that? That just seems, you know, too difficult. The good thing about video is it's not easy to go back to it over. Like a book, you can go back. It might overwhelm you or something. But hearing this, you hear it the first time, and you say, wow, that's very interesting. And you kind of let it smooth out a little bit. It'll smooth out. Go back and hear some other video but similar, you know, kind of content. It's like, oh, yeah, this is familiar to me, a little bit familiar to me. And then your hearing gets better, and you get it even better. And it goes like that. But, so it's a little more vibrant that way. And this on a video, it's a little different than a book. Problem with the birds is one day they won't be here. See, force change, season changing, forcing them to change their migration, their habits, their food source, all this stuff. Yeah. Wow. Hungry birds. They're not angry birds, they're hungry birds. They might be a little angry too because they're so hungry. I am free, I am still spirit as God created me. Absolutely. I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit as God created me. But keep in mind, God created us as absolute freedom, perfect absolute freedom. We can change our experiencing at any moment, to anything at all, or we can keep the experience exactly the same every moment, as long as we want. We can keep an experience for an instant, just for that one instant, and then go to another, or we can keep each instant, we can keep the exact same experience if we want to. No pressure either way. And because there's no pressure either way, that enables us to have this natural flow of experience and become way more adventurous when we realize we can go back to anything we want, anytime at all, with no pressure than to not do so. And we can keep it for as long as we want. Once you realize you can keep it for as long as you want, and it can always be exactly the same, then you become way more adventurous. So, paradoxically, by accepting this, you know, that we can keep whatever we want as long as we want and no pressure, we say, hey, that's great. I think I'm going to try all these other stuff too, you know. This is the why reality is very adventurous, naturally so. Not because we're forced to, but because we're so free to not be so also. You know, to keep whatever we want as long as we want, without any pressure whatsoever. Without any decay, any forced change, any residue, no, nothing. So, this is how it works. It's wonderful, so. All right. Again, distraction. I gotta watch myself. Another dreary day of just sitting in a chair. If I can just sort of sit in a chair doing pretty much nothing, I'll have to battle the ants some more. And you know, but just try and just stay uninteresting. Just don't hold the intensity of this. Just hold the intensity. Don't dissipate it. Just hold the intensity. All right. Very great. And that's it for this one.